While I was an inpatient in hospital after my surgery, nurses were supposed to check my blood pressure and my temperature every 4 hours to ensure that I didn't spike a post-op infection or fever. They never checked my blood pressure, they never checked my temperature, but magically my chart was updated every 4 hours.
In Sri Lanka, the doctor only gives you and says, this is what's wrong with you and this is what you need to do. I think the doctor needs to take a little bit more responsibility into helping the patient on the mental health side. And that information should be given to the patient. I see my oncologist once every 3 months. I saw him before my operation. My surgeon and the person who the doctor who diagnosed me, they're the ones who told me I had cancer. At no point was that kind of information ever given to me, either when I entered hospital, when I went through the surgery, after the surgery, by the doctor, by the nurse, by nobody.
I'm Natalie, I'm a single mom and photographer, and since May last year, I've been battling metastatic breast cancer.
My name is Shiraz Kalaratna. I'm a single parent, as unfortunately, sadly, I lost my wife to cancer about 7 years ago. Unfortunately, I myself was diagnosed with cancer in late 2019 with colon cancer. So I have been a caregiver, a family member, and a patient myself.
There are some things called the cardinal signs. So people should be aware of those cardinal signs. Things like long-standing cough, a change in your voice, difficulty in swallowing, long-standing fever, unexplained loss of weight, and also, you know, appearance of lymph nodes of the glands all over the body, unnecessary bleeding from your vagina, or especially after sexual intercourse, and change in your bowel habits, and change in your in one of your beauty spots. All these things could be a sign of a cancer. So they are called cardinal signs. That doesn't mean that you're having a cancer, but that is the time that you should go and meet a qualified doctor and get it sorted out. There are certain cancers which can be detected early by doing screening. The idea of screening is to find them when they're asymptomatic, before the symptoms appear. For instance, breast cancer, people can go for a mammogram. For a cervical cancer, people can go for a pap smear, and for oral cancer, you know, that is also very common in this country. People can go to a dental surgeon at least once in 6 months to get their oral cavity examined. And again, there's something called self-examination of the testicles. So these things are important.
The only thing we have to kind of compare to is Western media. And you know you're going to lose your hair. In my case, with breast cancer, I knew that there was a probability of losing my breasts. But beyond that, there's so many other things that I had to address in that process, in terms of healthcare, in terms of mental health, in terms of social attitudes, and I wasn't prepared for any of it, let's say.
Well, my first experience with cancer was when my wife was diagnosed. So yes, at that time it was very upsetting and sad because it was not me who was going through it, but somebody who I used to love and care very much. So, you know, there were so many questions and so many things that people did not have answers for. So that was a bit upsetting. But then I realized as we went through things that I don't think everybody knows everything about cancer. There's a lot of unknowns, and I think there's a lot of work that needs to be done in that area.
So there are other supportive, you know, it is not yet freely available in this country because it is a multidisciplinary thing, because it's not only the doctors. There are other stakeholders who can get involved in this, like, you know, spiritual leaders, social workers, psychologists. So it has to be a multidisciplinary approach, you know, holistic approach. It is not only giving the treatment for the cancer, but you need some sort of mental backup also with other organizations. So it is still lacking in this country, but things are picking up.
There were a lot of emotional confrontations that I wasn't prepared for. In the way that you are treated by healthcare workers, in the way that there are social attitudes around how a woman should appear even if they have cancer. And all of these confrontations obviously cause a severe emotional crisis. Not only are you battling cancer, you are battling a healthcare system and you're battling archaic social attitudes. So it's like a multi-layered battle altogether. You know, I've noticed that a lot of women cancer patients especially have this need to cover their heads because we have social norms around how a woman should look. It's not necessarily the cancer patient's fault. It's the fault of society at large in how we are viewing women's bodies, for instance. There's supposed to be a sense of shame attached to the fact that I had to lose my breasts. And I found this extremely confusing. I got breast cancer. This is not an illness. that I have caused on myself. The results of how to treat the illness shouldn't have to do with other people's attitudes. But should I hide the fact that I don't have breasts? Do I hide the fact that I don't have hair? Those unnecessary confrontations cause a bigger emotional crisis.
Mental health support, I don't want to say we don't have it here. It's just that I don't know about it. But I think there should be, you know, if you are diagnosed by a doctor and the doctor should tell you, here are the support systems, maybe as simply as having some pamphlets. You know, this is what is available, right? If you should need support. Sadly, in Sri Lanka, we don't talk about that.
Number one is to get referred to a correct place. And once they go to the doctor, they will do some further investigations to diagnose cancer correctly or to confirm the diagnosis. And then they will do so-called the staging, because cancers have different stages. Stage one, basically one, two, three, and four. So your treatment varies from stage to stage, you know. Early cancers can be treated easily, but when the stage is advanced, it becomes difficult. Now, treatment has changed drastically, not like those days. So basically, there are many type forms of modalities of treatment. Surgery is one modality, then chemotherapy is another modality, then radiation therapy, as well as hormone therapy. And there are a lot of novel therapies. Now, when you are treating a cancer patient, you call it tailor-made treatment. Each patient is assessed individually and you decide the correct treatment protocol for that patient.
The Cancer Society itself was formed in 1948. It's a non-governmental, non-profit organization. Then in 1997, it was approved by an Act of Parliament. And our mission is really to care and provide solace to cancer patients, as well as educate the public and create awareness about cancer. And the operations we do would be the homes, which is where it's like a transit place. It's like a hospital, 80 odd beds we have there, just next to the Apex Hospital, where people come for treatment and they can stay there. Then there is a cancer hospice, which is one of the earliest palliative care centers that privately done by in Sri Lanka, and that has about 32 beds, and that is really for people who are diagnosed with terminal cancer who can't be looked after at home, and we provide them with all the care that is necessary, palliative care, counseling, medicines, of course under doctor's guidance, pain management, proper diets, all that is done, and these services are free of charge. We also do a relief and rehabilitation that is for cancer survivors who are underprivileged. They're cancer survivors, so we give them monthly allowance plus dry rations and sometimes help them in their families. And then we also do public education, which is a really an important aspect of our society. But that is where we go out to the communities, conduct awareness programs about cancer, how to prevent, how to detect, and what treatment to take. That is basically a broad outline of what the Cancer Society does.
I think rage is the greatest motivator that I have. It's where all my inspiration comes from. And the angrier I got, the stronger I got, because I knew that I had to start talking about it, especially because we don't talk about cancer. There are no faces out there that represent this narrative. And it's not fair to all the new people who are diagnosed, myself included. I can't give advice. I can't, because I can only talk about my experience to other people. The only thing I can ask is to be authentic to your experience.
I very strongly believe, you know, keep a positive, be strong, keep a positive mindset. This really helps you, not just in your, it helps in your attitude, but also in your recovery. The next thing that I would say is, you know, if you're a person of faith, rely on your faith. You know, lean on the love and support of your family members. You know, so that's something that is important that will help you and help your family as well. The next thing is, you know, it is okay to feel sad, to feel weak, to feel to come have doubt. That's fine. It's okay. It's normal. You know, we're all human. But then overcome that, dig deep and come out stronger, come out positive.